Okay, so this is what I'll be talking about, and this is what you paid the admission fee for, right? Prevention of math anxiety and relationships. So first, we'll do this part. When I was doing my master's, I thought, okay, I will have to commit to something that I believe in, that I can put my heart and soul into. And honestly, I wish I remember how I stumbled upon preventing math anxiety, but turns out it was perfect. So what I did for my master's was talked about some of the myths about learning math, and that's how the math anxiety comes up. So we try to not have those issues. One of them was that you distrust your intuition. And intuition, by the way, the ability to understand something immediately without the need for conscious reasoning. So I think, well, wait, if somebody practices enough, then they just know it. I liken it to me on the tennis court. If I think about serving, But if I just do it, it's fine. So why not trust your intuition? At least get going, right? And it's funny that today I had a student in my class who said, sometimes I just doodle. And that movement gets you thinking, and then all of a sudden you know what to do, or at least how to start a problem. So good, keep those pencils moving. You have to get the exact answer. Seriously? Well, certainly if a doctor is giving me blood pressure medicine, I want to make sure she gives me the correct dose. But what about this guy? This woodchuck, if you want to know how much wood could have been, I don't think so. Sometimes close enough is good enough. And you're going to tell me if I'm holding this incorrectly. Good. Okay. So sometimes, yes, an exact answer is important, but sometimes close enough is good enough. There's only one way to do a problem. Hardly ever. For example, the problem I'm about to show you, I actually gave in one of my classes this semester. I had put up a bunch of problems on the first and second days of the semester so that I could see how students approach math. And, you know, did they get right into it? Did they sit there rolling their eyes? Did they find satisfaction when they got it right? And also about the content. Did they have any idea about some of it? So this was the third of the three problems I put up on the board. The first one was a geometry question. My gal A had the explanation for how to do the perimeter and the area. No problem, she explained it to the class. Next one was a trig question. My guy E, he knew the answer, explained it so well. Others were lost, but at least I knew I had a couple of experts on geometry and trig. This question is, okay, who's got the answer? Wait, you know it? You must be gifted. What is it?
16.
How did you get that?
3 plus 7 is 10. 1 plus 5 is 6. 10 and 6 is 16.
Interesting. See? Did you do it that way?
No.
How did you do it?
I went the other way.
You went just straight. That's a way. Aren't those? That's what you're thinking, right? Okay, well, what about this way? We know it's 16, and thank you both. You're experts. 1 plus 7 is 8. You did?
Yeah, 3 and 5 is 8.
You are also gifted. Wow. So then you said 2 times 8 is 16. Wow. All right. Well, smarty pants, I just happen to have another question at the ready. Go for it. God bless you. Look at that hot shot. Woohoo! You get an A plus. Okay, enough about you. What about this one? What a myth. Girls can't do math. What are you kidding me? I used to be a girl. So I know. Now, when I was doing my master's, honestly, all these myths, the fact that people got physically sick when doing math, I thought, how can there be such people? Honestly, okay, let me think. In high school, we did math. Beth, I know you're out there. One of my friends from high school said she was going to join the streaming part of this. Remember, Beth? Mr. Blank's class. And we just did math. We didn't think it was a big deal that we were girls. We just did it. And then I thought back to, did I have females? Kathy Floyd used to be in continuing ed, interviewed me when I was first at UVM. What inspired you to do math? Who inspired you? You just want to be a role model for other females? You're giving me way too much credit. No. I did math because I liked it. In fact, in college, I kept taking math. I was elementary education, as President Garamala said. But I kept doing math because that was what was fun for me. That was my break. And so this business is just a lie. Anybody can learn math. It just takes a lot of patience and showing different approaches. That's what it takes. So I talk about connections, not just with earlier math that you learn and how you build, but also the connections with people. In my classes, if I know my students, I can do such a better job. I don't see my students as, oh, you're just a bunch of people. I know who needs what. Some need humor, some need me to just buckle down and get down to business. And so do classes, right? There are the chemistry of the class. Sometimes I can be, believe it or not, and I know this will come as a shock to you, I can be a little bit silly. But every once in a great while, like probably every decade, I can be really serious in a class. But I have to read the audience and know, what do they need? How do they need me to be? The one-on-one. When students come in for office hours, it's great that they come in for help, but then as they're packing up their little bags and talk about home and roommate and everything else, that's when I really get to know them. And again, that helps me do a better job in the classroom because I understand my students. So it takes patience, respect, and belief. I found over the years that sometimes I believe in students way more than they believe in themselves. Like the young man who was booted from engineering, appealed a decision, was allowed back in. Sadly, a year or so later, was booted again. Kept going out, checking. Was his name on the list? When was he appealing? Nope. 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 I couldn't stand it. I called him and I said, what the heck? I said, when are you appealing? No, Rosie. No. I'm nervous. No, I can't. And I said, I don't think you heard the question. Not are you appealing, but when? And he said, no, Rosie, why are you being this way to me? I said, okay, I have a question. Are you willing to throw everything we have worked for? You're just gonna throw it away. I'm scared. I said, I understand. No, like I cannot face those people. This was the committee. And I said, okay, just, I'm a little slow, so let me get this straight. You can't, for 20 minutes of your valuable life, sit in a room with faculty members who might give you a chance to get your degree. Do I have that right? Why are you doing this to me? I said, you tell me you want to throw it all away, I'll respect that. I'm scared. I said, okay. And I said, I will be there every step of the way. Came in, did the appeal, came into the room, sat down. The person in charge said, okay, plead your case. He had his little paper up there. It was shaking so much the committee couldn't hear a word that he said. They were respectful, smiled but didn't giggle, and at the end did ask a couple questions. The person in charge had him leave the room so we could deliberate. We deliberated, decided. We let him back once. Okay, he wasn't going to make Dean's List. He wasn't going to be a top scholar, but he'd made it this far. We let him back. But when she said to him, your committee has made the decision that you can stay, he almost fell off his chair. He looked like, what is wrong with you people? Like, why are you letting me back in? And she dismissed him to go out in the hall and say, okay, we're done with you. You know, reach out to Rosie. You'll plan the rest of your schedule for the rest of the time here at UVM. And he graduated. So, yep. I believed in him more than he believed in himself. They will know. When I was in college, I always thought I would be teaching kindergartners. And I thought, those little punks, they're going to know. And it's no different. Little ones, middle school, high schoolers, college students, traditional age college students, the 80-year-old woman I had, they will know if you care about them. So if I ever feel like I'm not connecting with someone, I call them in and say, either this is the way I teach. If you don't like it, let me help you switch to somebody else's section. If you're stuck with me because I'm the only one who teaches a class, then let's figure out how to make this work. Because I can adjust, but I want you to understand why I do what I do. And fortunately, it works out. So here's a plug for Catamount Core. We believe in students, and soon our little darlings here will be doing the Catamount Core curriculum. And they will be so lucky that we care enough about them that we are preparing them for the world. That's what this is all about. And Pablo and I both promise you that we will work our tails off to make sure that this goes smoothly. And John Sama, I'm not forgetting that you're a big part of this too. These two guys work so hard on this, and I'm grateful. So, the relationship building part. This was the first year I advised Golden Key, the International Honor Society. At the end of the year, I came back to my office and found this on my desk. When I first took over Golden Key, I thought, my gosh, I'm going to have to sit in a room once a month for an hour and just be there with smart people. This will be dreadful. Turned out, though, Ryan, who was the president when I first took over, he and I definitely hit it off, and we had a lot of fun making no-soap blankets and selling fudge, and it was great. And students tell me that it's a break for them from their studies because these students work really hard. So making connections with students outside the classroom is also a really big deal for me. This is a little video that I happened upon when I was looking to see if there's anything I should talk to you folks about.
Favorite professor so far at UVM has been Joan Rosebush, and she was just probably one of the best math teachers I've had. She was really engaging and just made me really love the subject of math. So yeah.
Thank you.
So I put that in here because you never know the littlest thing you say, the littlest thing you do makes a difference for students. That girl, I always liked her well enough, but I didn't think we made a really tight connection. And sometimes I worry that what she was kind enough to say, my energy, some have said things not quite so complimentary, but my energy was good for her. So I thought that was worth showing. Oh, these two, Lindsay and Bobby, were here as undergrads. They went out and did real life for a while and then came back and did their graduate degrees. And we've stayed in touch, so connections with them for the long haul.
And guess what she's doing?
Teaching!
She got an engineering PhD degree and decided to go into teaching math because of Rosie.
God bless her. Thank you.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. You're going to pay for it, but just in a few minutes. So this is something that around Christmas time this past year, I, out of the blue, got this email. Your two favorite students reconnected last night in Seattle, and we had to snap a photo to send you. We were telling our partners about how we used to make you cards of us to put on your desk. So Mike and Britt were together, and Mike said to Britt, send this picture to Rosie. Oh my God, how can you not love those faces? And it's true, they used to periodically, they'd be out having fun, take pictures, and then they'd make a little card that I would have on my desk until they said, gave me another one. Yes, Mike and Britt, adorable. This gal, Jill, got in touch with me this past summer. She was one of the tutors. I first ran the tutoring program here at UVM. That was my first job here. And she wrote to me over the summer. We'd stayed in touch a little bit. I have to see you. I'm coming for alumni weekend. I said, of course, I would love to see you. As we approached each other, I said, Jill, do you have any idea how long it's been? She said, I know exactly how long it's been, 25 years. I graduated 25 years ago. We walked up to my office, sat down. It was as if we had been together the week before, picked right up where we left off. Isn't she a cutie? Oh, these two hoodlums, Stevie Wonder and Wyatt. These are two of my athletes, always would sit in the front row. If ever they were a little bit late, I'd say, correct me if I'm wrong, but I thought if you were in track, you were supposed to be fast. What the heck is your problem? So they were out with Wyatt's parents recently, got this photo and said, we have to send it to Rosie. They also told me to put it as my desktop background, which I did for a long time. This, oh my gosh, one graduation, I was lining up our little darlings. So, you know, I'm kind of busy, you know, like checking their little numbers, making sure they're in alphabetical order. And I hear, Rosie! And I said, I'm kind of busy. And the whole row said, no, Rosie, you better turn around. Okay, I hear those words and I think, oh my gosh, what's wrong? And I turned around and there they were. So I have an impression now that even if you don't know me at all, by now you're getting a little idea about how I operate in the world. Relationships are just a smidge important to me. Remember this? Okay, so the class I teach for the Rubenstein School, day one, I told the class that I already fell in love with them, and I said, and what about that dean of yours? Isn't he amazing? Like, we don't know who our dean is. I said, you must meet him. So I was scheming a little bit that I would have a special guest in my class one day, but these two students sent me this picture and said, there was a Dean Strong in the flesh. And I said, oh my gosh. So I put that as a slide in my class the next day. And they all got a kick out of it. And then we actually watched one of your videos. Yeah. Bird calls. It was wonderful. Yeah. So it's nice to make connections, not just with the students in the class, but it's important to me that students know that I've made connections around campus, so if they need something, I can reach out for them and help them. Dr. Todd's there. Yep, we've done that a number of times. Oh, and what about this? I decided on about my, Brian, are you listening? It was probably about my 500th version of this presentation. I decided to take a little break and look on Facebook. And I know you can read, but I'm nervous that somebody in the back might not be able to see it. So, Rosie, I would like you to meet Josie, named after Carly's father. I'm going to get emotional. Carly's father, Joe, and a great mentor named Joan Rosebush Rosie. So that's R, and the parents have given me permission to call her R, little Josie Grace. Ben definitely has a special place in my heart, and he has made it in his career, and look at that, connections he made. Oh, and Carly is also wonderful. I've been lucky enough to meet her. So success in his career and success in real life. So a little change of tune here. This is my guy of many years. Many of you have said, how on earth do you put in the hours you put? And, well, trust me, obviously I don't get much beauty sleep. You're laughing at me. But Carl has been wonderful, really supportive. He couldn't be here tonight, but he is watching the live stream. So he's why. So thank you, Carl. I love you. So he is two of my six legs that I have at home. Are you ready? Oh, my gosh. Look at that. That's our little rocket. I know. He's gifted. You should know that. Look at him. He's beautiful. So aside from my six legs, Mom, Dad, and my wonderful brother, Dick, who are all up in heaven, thank you for teaching me how to work as a team, how to see the humor in things. Sometimes I do find things a little bit funny, and how to love. Thank you. Also, I would like to thank all my colleagues, many of whom are here tonight. I've learned so much from you. Sometimes, wow, I'm going to have to try that. Sometimes, never. Not in a million years could I pull that off. Nope. And my administrators, present, past, thank you. You have given me so many opportunities I never could have imagined. Thank you, sincerely. And to Foster and Eric, we've worked together many, many times, and it's just so perfect that you are here tonight. It's perfect. Yeah. And for parents in the audience watching the stream, thank you for sharing your little bundles of joy with me. I promise I've done my best, and it's great to still be connected. Sometimes still with students or advisees, and sometimes I'm still in touch with the parents and everyone, so I'm like, oh yeah, how's that son of yours doing? So it's a family affair, and I love that part. Also, to the many students whom I've had over the years and the advisees, as was mentioned, the advisees, academic advisees, advisees in some of the fraternities, sororities, the clubs. It's been a pleasure. You have such a special place in my heart. Isn't that a great shot of Donna Rizzo? So.
I'm going to use that on my webpage.
Okay. To follow in your footsteps is just unbelievable to me. Doing this work that I love and to get an award for it just seems wrong, truly. So, great shot. I told you you'd get yours. You're welcome. And to all the folks in the alumni house, thank you. You've been so helpful and so patient with me as I've come and tested things out, and you've made sure that everything is perfect. Thank you. And to the Kidder family, thank you. So remember this guy? Yeah. I'm sure you're wondering. So here's the answer. 362 cubic centimeters per day. Yeah. You were wondering. I know. Some of you already had your phones out, checking things out. Clayton, what's wrong?
It doesn't seem like enough.
You know what?
I always thought woodchucks were industrious. That's a piffling amount.
I'd just like to announce publicly that sometimes you're too much. But I still love you. And
he knows they do it with their teeth, right?
He's tried, but and that's a whole other story. Okay, and thank you to all of you here in the room with me and watching remotely or eventually watching the recording, right, that they're going to be able to see. Look at those, Foster and Eric, you're wonderful. Thank you. So thank you for being here. I hope you learned something about preventing math anxiety and a little bit about building relationships. Thank you.
I don't know why I have to follow that, Rosie. Thank you. What a wonderful talk, and for sharing different approaches to make connections, whether it's with numbers or with people. And I really appreciated the power of patience and respect and belief in students to really ensure their success. So thank you for that. So for those of you who don't know, I'm Patty Prelock, the Provost and Senior Vice President here at the University of Vermont. And in my role, I have the privilege of overseeing those areas that directly impact students and their lives, including academic affairs, student success, and student life. And I have a very talented and dedicated team of deans and vice provosts focusing on really creating a world of educational experience that prepares students to really thrive in a very diverse and ever-changing world. So I think Rosie has to be at every one of my training meetings as I'm bringing new people on so that they understand the power of developing relationships. And clearly faculty are central to that, and you can see that in Rosie and the work she does. You know, when they review nominations for the Kidder Award, the Alumni Association really looks at four different components where an individual excels, and that is excellence in teaching, which Rosie has done for over 30 years, effectiveness in inspiring students, which clearly she's an inspiration with all of these students sending things back to her saying, this is the impact you made on my life. Commitment to student advising, one of the best advisors we have on campus, and the ability to really constructively influence campus beyond the classroom. And she's done that in so many ways and in so many committees. And I've had the pleasure of seeing her work in Golden Key with students. So we couldn't have found a more deserving candidate than Rosie. I'm sure one thing that they noticed when reviewing her CV is the number of times she's been the first to get a new award or recognition, and rightly so. She has been a trailblazer and an innovator, and dedication has been exemplary and not afraid to do her thing in her way to make a difference. She's also a true leader, as Pablo said, in our faculty, and has built her career on the nexus between teaching and advising and guiding students, and she really flourishes in that space. She really puts student success at the center of everything she does. And she creates these environments in which every student feels like they belong and they truly matter. And in fact, in our 6-week survey this year, for the first time we said, do you feel you matter? And I want every single one of the students to be able to say yes. And Rosie, you have really helped that happen for our students, so thank you. You're really invested there in our success. So personally, I'm always happy to see an email from Rosie, because I know no matter how rough my day was, if I open that, I'm just going to see her smile, her emojis, and just imagine her in the classroom and what she is doing with students. She exudes positivity and optimism and possibilities for students for this institution. And I always know I can count on her to see challenges through a lens of opportunity. She's a difference maker in all the right ways. She's a campus leader who gets to yes. And I'm forever grateful for that partnership. I need a lot more of you. So thank you for everything that you've done. The world needs lots of Rosie educators, and I'm confident, as you can see, she's inspired so many students to be agents of change and to follow in her footsteps. And Rosie, while you share that you learn from students, it is clear that you have had a profound impact on the UVM experience and the life experience of many of your students and your colleagues. So thank you for all you do for UVM, and congratulations again. And I believe Claire's coming back up, so thank you.
Thank you, Provost Prelock, for sharing those reflections with us, and thank you, Rosie, for your excellent lecture. The Kidder Award is a wonderful tradition that is sustained by the enthusiasm of our university community at all levels. So thank you all for the roles you play in supporting and recognizing outstanding teaching at UVM. This concludes our formal program. Now please join us for a reception in the lobby. Rosie will join you as soon as we've had a chance to take a few photos. Thank you all for coming.